Welcome, everyone, to this afternoon's hearing on the offshoring of research, development, and innovation. I also want to welcome our very distinguished witnesses. All are leading experts in the impacts of globalization, and we look forward to hearing your thoughts. As is widely recognized, our competitiveness and our high standard of living are derived largely from our technological superiority. But almost on a daily basis, we read announcements that more high-tech jobs are being offshored to developing countries. For example, Accenture's CEO announced that it will have more employees in India than in the U.S. by August. At the same time, many firms are investing in R&D facilities in low-wage developing countries. These centers are working on a cutting-edge research and new products development rivaling their U.S. centers. A recent University of Texas study, you'll appreciate, found that of the 57 major announcements of locations of global technological R&D facilities in the past year, more than 60% were located in Asia versus a mere 9% located in the U.S. But this seems to be only the tip of the iceberg. One of our witnesses, Dr. Alan Binder, has established or estimated that more than one in four American jobs are vulnerable to offshoring. Even more striking is his finding that most American science and engineering jobs are vulnerable to offshoring. We've already seen how offshoring is adversely affecting student choices to pursue science and technological careers. According to Computing Research Association, enrollment in undergraduate computing or computer science programs has dropped an astonishing 40% over the last 4 years. And I want to make clear that I'm not casting blame. Companies are simply responding to an increasingly globalized marketplace and high-tech workforce. What we want to do is make certain that companies find that the U.S. engineers, scientists, and students are the best in the world. That is the committee's goal. We want to make sure that we enact policies that keep us from having to offshore our future. Unless the United States maintains its edge in innovation, which is founded on a well-trained, creative workforce, the best jobs may soon be found offshore. If current trends continue for the first time in our nation's history, our children may grow up with a lower standard of living than their parents. There is no single cause for this concern being raised. There is no single policy prescription available to address them. But looking the other way and hoping for the best is irresponsible. The stakes are simply too high to adopt a don't worry, be happy approach. In Congress, in this Congress, we've already done a lot of work to address this set of issues. We've passed a number of legislative initiatives based on the recommendations of experts from the national academies. But this should be viewed only as a necessary start. There is much more work to be done. Today's hearing is the first in a series of fact-finding explorations of the implications of offshoring to U.S. competitiveness. We will listen to all sides, soliciting the best expertise and advice so that we can develop the policies that will lead to a strong economic future for our country. Now I'd like to recognize my colleague, the ranking member from Texas, Mr. Hall, for an opening statement.
Mr. Chairman, I thank you. And this must be a special group here, and highly recognized group, because it's the first time in my 27 years I've been here that he's given you 10 minutes to state your position on, and I'm anxious to hear it, so I'll be as quickly as I can with my short. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate you holding this hearing on globalization of R&D and innovation, an issue that's going to affect our country and economy, we know, for a lot of years to come, and this could be one of the most important hearings that we've had in a long, long time. And I'm looking forward to the hearings and the statements from all the witnesses, each of whom is considered an expert in the field. And I know it's going to be an educational and a very informative debate. I think we'll hear today, what we hear was going to dovetail with some of the testimony heard from the authors of the Rising Above the Gathering Storm report. And a lot of people have argued that we really know very little about the types of jobs that are being offshored. Once upon a time, it's thought that only low-skilled jobs were in danger of being offshored. However, it seems that highly educated people in good-paying jobs are now just as threatened by the phenomena of offshoring. Last year, China graduated 219,600 engineers, representing 39% of all the bachelor's degrees in that country. The U.S., on the other hand, graduated only 59,500 engineers, or 5% of all the bachelor's degrees. Furthermore, 58% of all degrees awarded last year in China were in physical sciences and engineering, compared to 17% in the United States, a figure that's dropping by about 1% a year. Of the U.S. science and technology workforce, 38% of the PhDs were foreign-born in the year 2000. I don't know what it's been in the year since that time or if there are any figures on that, but in this global economy, our children are going to be competing head-to-head with Chinese and Indian students, but many say that they aren't taking the necessary classes or making their education work for them. And when our children graduate from high school, they've taken consistently fewer classes in math and science than their contemporaries across the globe. And yet, how much do we really know about offshoring? Many have argued that we haven't adequately measured the effects of offshoring on our workers or on our economy. Our government needs to do a better job developing metrics that will give us the information we need to make informed decisions about trade and the economy. Many jobs and many plants have been offshored over the past several years, and we all know examples from our home states. But I think what's even more concerning is the amount of R&D that's being permanently offshored and will not be coming back to the USA. As the authors of The Rising Above the Gathering Storm wrote, and I quote, "It's easy to be complacent about U.S. competitiveness and preeminence in science and technology. We have led the world for decades, and we continue to do so in many fields, but the world is changing rapidly, and our advantages are no longer unique," unquote. So if we continue to lose our R&D and high-tech work to foreign competitors, we're going to have a long, steep hill to climb to keep our economy going. Mr. Chairman, I still applaud you for holding this hearing to highlight the issue of globalization and offshoring, and I look forward to working with you in a subsequent hearing on this important issue. And I thank these four gentlemen for the time it took them to get to the position where they're as important as they are, and to take their time off here to give us the benefits of their knowledge and the time it'll take to get back to their homes today. I appreciate them, and I appreciate you. Yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Hopefully we'll hear more about that University of Texas report today, too. If there are additional members who would wish to submit opening statements, your statements will be made a part of the record. We're very lucky to have this very distinguished panel of witnesses before us today to launch the first in a series of hearings addressing the topic of offshoring. Dr. Alan Bender is a professor of economics at Princeton and former vice chair of the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve System. Dr. Ralph Gomory is president of the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation and was head of IBM research for 16 years. Dr. Martin Baily is senior fellow at the Peterson Institute of International Economics and senior advisor to McKinsey Global Institute. And Dr. Thomas Duesterberg is the president of the Manufacturing Alliance and former assistant secretary of international economic policy at the Commerce Department. You are a very distinguished group. As Mr. Hall said, it's unusual that we are expanding our time, but we want to hear from you. Let me give, I guess, the members and our witnesses a little update. It's expected that we're going to have votes at 2, which means at about 2:10 we are going to dash out of here. And unfortunately, there's going to be a series of votes and a photograph. And so if we can, I think that we need to do this is in full respect to you coming here, but I think we'll be better off to try to accomplish this before then if we can, so that we don't have to let our panel continue to wait. And with that, I'll be quiet and call on Dr. Binder.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Thanks for the opportunity to take part in this hearing. I was asked to talk about the offshoring of American jobs in general and with specific attention to science and technology issues, and I want to start with some general observations and then get to some specifics. To start with, Americans don't have any biological superiority to workers in developing countries, and yet we earn much higher wages. So why is that? Well, One factor is that we're on average much better educated, but the average is not the only relevant thing. Millions of skilled workers in developing countries are educated about as well, in some cases better, than Americans are. And importantly, those numbers are bound to increase as poor countries continue to participate more vigorously and effectively in the world economy. Apart from better education and skills, the other main reasons why U.S. workers earn so much more than workers in, say, India or China is that Americans work with much better technology and with much better physical capital, again, on average. But physical capital, financial capital, and technology are all increasingly mobile these days, and so in particular, the capital and the technology can move to where the cheap labor is, and we see that this is happening. This is all very old hat. It describes a situation that's been familiar to U.S. manufacturing workers and businesses for decades, as millions of manufacturing jobs have been offshored from the United States and also other rich countries. This is not an American story in particular, to an ever-changing list of poorer countries, which if you go way back included Japan, which is not a poor country anymore, but these days, of course, is headed by China. The new wrinkle today is in services, where a similar process is unfolding, or I really should say just beginning to unfold, I think. Advances in electronic communications have decreased and in some cases obliterated the advantages of physical proximity in a wide variety of service jobs, simply because the work can be performed abroad or anywhere and delivered by telephone or by internet or by some other method. While still in its infancy, electronic offshoring has already begun to move well beyond traditional low-end jobs like call center operators to highly skilled jobs such as computer programming, engineering, and security analysis, just to name a few. And I think there's little doubt that both the range and the number of jobs that will be able to be delivered electronically is going to increase greatly as the technology improves and as countries like India, China, and others educate more and more skilled workers. In the case of India in particular, these are going to be English-speaking workers, which is quite germane. So what's novel about service offshoring? At the basic conceptual level, the pure economics, nothing much. The same basic market forces that govern trade in goods also govern trade in services. The novelty, to my mind, comes at the practical level, and specifically, I have in mind three things. First, there are many, many more service jobs than manufacturing jobs in all the rich countries. In the United States, the ratio is about 5 to 1, five times as many service jobs as manufacturing jobs. Secondly, unlike factory workers, the people who hold these jobs are not accustomed to competing with low-cost foreign labor. And you can be sure that they're not going to like it any more than the manufacturing workers did when this phenomenon hit manufacturing. And third, that many white-collar professionals who will feel threatened by offshoring, if they don't already, are vocal and politically engaged. So you can all judge for yourselves better than I can, but this strikes me as a potentially potent political brew. With that said, I want to turn to some specifics. First, which service jobs are the most vulnerable to offshoring? It would be nice to say that only low-skilled jobs are vulnerable while high-skilled jobs will remain in America. And as Mr. Hall said, we may have believed that once, but it doesn't appear to be the case. My research finds hardly any correlation at all between either the educational attainment of an occupation or its average wages, on the one hand, and the degree of offshore ability of the job. So what is the critical factor that determines which jobs can easily be offshored and which cannot? I've argued that it's a little discussed and often unnoticed job characteristic, which is the importance of face-to-face contact. And I mean by that face-to-face contact with people outside the work unit, not with your fellow workers. For lack of a pre-existing vocabulary, I have called the jobs in which face-to-face contact is vital to performing the service, personal services, and the occupations in which it is not, impersonal services. So, for example, services that can be delivered by telephone or internet, like call centers and financial analysis, are by this definition impersonal, and that means they're potentially tradable across national borders, just like manufactured goods. But services that have to be delivered physically or face-to-face, like driving a cab or brain surgery, or serving in Congress, I might add, or whose quality deteriorates markedly when they're delivered electronically, such as, say, high school teaching or psychoanalysis, those are personal services, and they're not going to be traded internationally, at least probably not. But my central claims about this phenomenon are two. The first is that market pressures emanating from trade and globalization will force, and I want to underscore the verb, force more and more Americans to leave impersonal service and manufacturing jobs and to seek employment in personal service jobs instead. And second, that we'll be better off as a nation if government, businesses, and the schools approach the coming occupational migration, and that's what it is, a large-scale occupational migration, deliberately, thoughtfully, and with appropriate policy responses rather than letting it take us by surprise. Now, in voicing those views, I seem to have created a bit of a media stir, as some of you may know. So I'd like first to quickly avoid three confusions that are often made. Some people have misinterpreted my estimate of 30 to 40 million U.S. jobs as potentially offshoreable to mean that all those jobs will be lost. They won't. We haven't lost all manufacturing jobs, and they're all offshoreable. We will not lose all of these. Second, some have interpreted my writings as being hostile to trade, and that's just not true. I've always been an advocate of open trade, and I still am. Protectionism is a loser's game. That's not a game that America should be playing. Third, some people have misinterpreted my writings as hostile towards India in particular. I mentioned the relevance in India. That's not true. On the contrary, I applaud India. I think they're doing exactly the right thing for their people, exploiting the comparative advantage they have in English, building up service offshoring industries, and not incidentally, in the process, contributing mightily to the reduction of world poverty. This is all terrific. On the other hand, the one criticism of my work to which I do plead guilty, but I want to explain the guilt, is emphasizing the downsides of service offshoring rather than the upsides, and there are both. And I do that for a very simple reason, because I think that Americans in general and American policymakers especially need to focus on and think about ameliorating the downsides of offshoring, both for basic fairness reasons and if we're to preserve the open trading system against the forces of protection. The people who win from offshoring won't object to it one little bit, and the markets will produce the upsides without the government lifting a finger. But offshoring and trade more generally don't look so attractive to the people that lose their jobs in the process, and that's where the government needs to help. I'm watching my time. Having just ruled out the stop the world, I want to get off approach, the question is what Congress can do to make this transition a bit easier. I actually see three large policy agendas, and given the time, I'm just going to be able to tick them off, basically, and maybe we can come back if there's a question period. First, there's the safety net agenda. Put very simply, the U.S. government now offers disgracefully little help to workers who are displaced from their jobs, whether that's because of trade or for any other reasons. Without going into a great detail, I'm talking about stingy unemployment insurance, very weak trade adjustment assistance, the prospect of losing your health insurance, your pension rights, and so on. And also, by the way, very scant opportunities for retraining. I can't believe that our country can't do better than that, and I know other countries do better than that. Secondly, there's an educational agenda. I like to put it this way. We built our educational system in the 19th century to produce legions of factory workers for the first industrial revolution. It was a great success, but that's over. And we haven't really adopted yet to the second industrial revolution, which is the shift to services. Having not done that, we have to adopt now to what I think might be a third industrial revolution, which is the shift away from impersonal services to the personal service jobs that will remain in America. And virtually nobody in this country is thinking about how to do this right now. Third, and closest to the hearts of this committee, I believe, is the innovation agenda. And I'd like just like to give an illustrative example of why this is important. If you think about the television manufacturing industry, not television shows, but manufacturing, it began here, and once upon a time, lots of Americans had good jobs making televisions. But then, as this became a commodity, it migrated offshore, and as I'm sure you all know, the number of TV sets made in America is zero and has been for years. As a result of that, television manufacture is often held up as an example of industrial failure because we started it and then we lost it. I think it's important that we think of that as an example of industrial success. The leader, and that's our role, must constantly innovate and move on like the cowboy in the westerns. And that's just what we did in that case. We got there first, then we left as it migrated abroad. Both parts of that are very important, getting there first and then letting it go when it's time to let go. 52 seconds?
No, you're 52 seconds over. But you...
Oh, I'm 52 seconds over. So let me... I'm sorry. What does that mean?
Yeah, go ahead and conclude.
I just want to conclude. What does that mean? It means that we have to remain the hotbed of business creativity and innovation in the United States. So that goes to support for basic research, for industrial R&D, for creative business management, for the entrepreneurial culture that we're so good at, for open and vibrant but honest capital markets. These are the things, I think, that we need to think about in order to move forward and maintain the leadership position that America's had for so long. Thank you all for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Binder. Let me also remind everybody that this is being televised, so although folks are at different committees and things are going on, our staff as well as members are watching others from here, so we're more gaining this information than just the ones here directly. So Dr. Ralph Gomory, please. Or is Dr. Baily? All right. We'll go. Then Dr. Baily. Really matter. So we'll...
I'll start. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the committee for giving me this opportunity to talk. Like Alan, I was a member of the Clinton administration, and I support, I think, virtually all the policies that he described, and I'm very much in tune with that end of what he said. And I suspect I'll probably agree with many of the policies that Dr. Gomory proposes. On the other hand, I think the tone that I want to use is a bit more favorable towards globalization and its benefits to the United States than I think Alan, the remarks Alan made, and I suspect the ones that Dr. Gomory is going to make based on his opinions that I've heard before. Alan mentioned that the benefits of globalization are going to come anyway. In other words, you don't have to advocate those, you're going to get those. And it's important to point to some of the costs that do need to be ameliorated by actions in the policy environment. Well, to some extent, I agree with that, but I think globalization is getting such a bad rap at the moment that I want to try to level that intellectual playing field a little bit, because I do think it's brought tremendous benefits to the United States. It's made the U.S. much more competitive, more productive. We've had access to better technology. We've had access to capital. And by the way, I would mention that one of the comments that Alan made, other people make, is that, well, U.S. capital is going to flow overseas. The fact of the matter is about 80% of the available capital in the global economy is actually coming to the United States, only 15% to other countries. So we're benefiting from a tremendous inflow. Now, there are costs to that inflow also. I think the problem is a couple of things. One is that we've gotten our exchange rate out of whack, and I think that's one reason that globalization's got a bad name, because it's made it very hard for manufacturers and now service industries to compete. We have a natural comparative advantage in service industries, which you can see even today in the trade surplus that we have in services. So we're actually insuring service sector jobs to the United States and have been for many years. But we're facing an uphill struggle there because of the exchange rate, and that's certainly been true of manufacturing, where we've got a huge deficit and have had for a long time. The other problem, and I agree with the one that Alan mentioned, is that we do very little to help with training workers, with adjustments of workers. I'm actually just back from a trip to Europe, and I met with a number of leaders in Brussels, including those from Denmark that developed a so-called flex security system there, which gives their workforce a great deal of flexibility, but it also gives it a great deal of security that you get trained, you get pushed towards another job. It's a very tough-minded system. You can't just stay on benefits forever. You have to go get another job. You're required to do that. But at the same time, you're not left out there on your own. I think the United States is very good at the flexibility side. It's not been so good at the security part. Europe is very good at the support. The security side has not been very good at the flexibility. And I think both have to be there. I don't think we could transmit the Danish system as it is to the United States, but I think there's some important lessons to be learned there. Let me turn now to the more on the science and technology side, and I'm going to mention a little more on the benefits, and then I'll deal with what I see as some of the challenges or problems. The U.S. actually has benefited substantially from an inward brain drain. The OECD, in a report published in February of this year, notes that nearly 26% of the doctorates in the United States are foreign-born. Of these, 54% have become naturalized U.S. citizens. I'm one of them, I might note. Most of these come from Asia and Europe, and many of them actually received their doctorates with foreign education. So we are actually, even though we're the richest country or richest large country in the world, we're actually benefiting from the education that's being provided to people overseas. There are actually very few U.S. citizens that go overseas. And the people that come to the U.S. cite the economic opportunities here and the tremendous infrastructure that we have here, the scientific and technological community that is really continues to lead the world. Okay, let me talk on the challenges side a little bit more. A lot of the concerns about offshoring are around the computer and high-tech industry and programming industry, and I understand why. There are huge numbers of jobs being created in R&D centers and programming centers overseas, including China and India. This is an industry that has for a number of years been very globalized. It really is. The production, the manufacturing, a lot of that is done overseas. A lot of the companies are Americans, but that's been, that industry has been sliced and diced and put overseas. One thing I would say, though, to qualify that is, and that's in Table 1 in my testimony developed by one of my colleagues at the Institute, and it shows that even in the computer and high-tech fields, employment is growing in the U.S. in the higher-level areas. It's gone down in a lot of the basic programming areas and some of the call center stuff. Those kinds of jobs have gone overseas, and they're not, I wouldn't want to minimize the cost of that. But a lot of those high-tech jobs are still growing in the United States, even though this high-tech sector itself has seen a substantial kind of downturn since 1999, the period that I start with. I also want to say that the U.S. benefits from the low-cost hardware that's produced around the world, and we benefit from the software that's made around the world. If software is developed in India and China and used here in the United States, we gain the benefits of that for the productivity of our companies. On the policy side, I see I'm racing through my time before I got halfway through my comments here. On the policy side here, I think at some level we have to embrace the fact that science and technology is a global endeavor. It really is. I don't think we can shut it off in any way. I think that means we have to allow foreign-born scientists and engineers to come to the United States. And I've talked to some of them that get pretty lousy treatment when they apply these days. So there are scientists and technologists that want to come to the United States, want to become Americans, want to create American jobs, and they get treated guilty before they have and have to prove their innocence. So I think there's something that needs to be done there. Obviously, we have to protect the U.S. We can't have another 9/11. I understand that concern, but I don't think it's necessary for us to treat those people badly. Second point is we certainly have to fund scientific research, and we are funding scientific research. I know this committee is in favor of that, so I'm preaching to the choir here, but obviously in a time of budget tightness, we really do need to make sure that we keep up our scientific community. We put a lot of money on medical research, and that's fine. We just need to make sure that things like material science and the whole scientific endeavor gets adequate funding. And then, as Alan said, on education support, India has done a good job of training its college graduates, its computer programmers. I would note that the Indian education system as a whole is pretty awful. they have huge rates of illiteracy. So I don't think we would look to the Indian system as a good system, but one part of it that's good, that really has been the push of their education system, is at the higher end, and they've done a good job of creating programmers and people with mathematics and science skills. And here in the U.S., we need to do a better job in that dimension. Now, a lot of Americans don't want to study those things. They don't want to take mathematics and science. And so what can we do there? Well, I think there is a certain amount that can be done with funding on that area. If we provide scholarships, I think more people will go to graduate school in science and technology. And finally, the other part, I think, of embracing the global nature of this is that both as businesses and as a society, we need to be open to the innovation that's made around the world. Somebody has called it rather inelegantly blowback innovation. That's an unfortunate name, but it means that a lot of stuff that's going on around the world can come back and make the U.S. more productive. Let me say a word about offshoring. I was involved in a study that looked at offshoring. We did a lot of interviews of companies. We went and looked at those people with their educational qualifications, all the engineers coming out of China. How many of them really have serious engineering qualifications? How many of them can speak English, would actually substitute for American workers? How many people are involved in face-to-face stuff like that? We came up with a more conservative number than Alan did. Now, part of this is the time horizon, but I don't think that's the ultimate question, because we concluded that only 11% of jobs could ultimately be offshore, not the number that Alan has. The number that will be offshore over the next few years is certainly smaller, as Alan agreed. Let me conclude by saying that I think the U.S. has been and still is a great place for science and technology and innovation. It's been one of our huge strengths. So the issue should be to let's build on this strength. Let's not be too scared of what's happening around the world. Let's build on the strength we have and make sure we remain in that position. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Baily. And now, Dr. Gomory, we will now get to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to take part in this important hearing. The subjects we're going to discuss today are the ones to which I have devoted much of my life, and so this opportunity means a great deal to me, and I thank you. I will make only one basic point in all my testimony, and it's this. In this new era of globalization, the interests of companies and countries have diverged, and this divergence of goals enormously complicates the issue of national competitiveness. Countries have always looked to their companies to be productive and thus to be able to provide productive and high-paying jobs and contribute strongly to the total output of the country, its GDP, gross domestic product. GDP is what countries want from their companies. Companies have always needed profits, both to survive and to do something for their shareholders. And these two different sounding goals were once tightly linked, but that has changed. Globalization has now made it possible for global corporations to pursue their profits by building capabilities abroad instead of investing in the U.S. and using R&D to increase their U.S. productivity. Corporations today have the option of producing goods and services abroad using low-cost labor and import the goods or services into the U.S. But in creating their profits in this way, they are building up the total output of goods and services of other countries while breaking their once tight links with America's own GDP, America's output. The effect on the United States of the internationalization of the scientific and technical enterprise must be understood as one part of this revolutionary process of globalization. The role of science and technology in globalization is very special. S&T does not contribute to a nation's wealth by employing large numbers of people in high value-added or high-wage jobs. It contributes by supporting a relatively small number of people whose work is intended to give a competitive edge to the end products, whether that end product is goods like cars and computers or services like call centers or advanced medical services. It is these end products, not the R&D itself, that make up the bulk of a country's output. And most of corporations' revenues and support the jobs and wages of its employees. It is the competitive edge that is obtained from R&D. If in the process of globalization, the production or delivery of services and of the end product moves overseas, so do the wages. Even if R&D should remain behind, which in the long run it tends not to do, the vast bulk of value creation has moved to another country, and it is there that it supports the wages and GDP of that country. And this is an important shift. The productivities, the ability to produce goods, services of both countries have changed. It is at this point that a common confusion enters. The theory of free trade is invoked to say that although such shifts are painful to those who lose their jobs, they will find new ones. And the result is cheaper and better goods that benefit consumers, so that overall the country comes out ahead. However attractive this idea, it is in fact an incorrect characterization of the theory of free trade. Free trade owes its deserved appeal to the sound notion that if all countries produce the things at which they are relatively best and then trade these goods and services with countries which themselves produced what they supply best, then the global community and all its people will benefit. This is free trade, and I am a supporter of it. But in the economic analysis that produces this very favorable view of free trade, productive capabilities to make goods and services are taken as fixed. It is goods that are traded, but the ability to produce them is fixed. And that is not just a limitation of the theory, because it is easy to show that the uniformly benign results of free trade theory simply do not apply if there are also productivity shifts. Globalization, therefore, is not free trade, because it does involve productivity shifts. When the U.S. trades semiconductors for Asian sneakers, for example, that is trade. And the conclusions of economic theory is that this type of exchange clearly benefits both countries. But when U.S. companies build semiconductor plants and R&D facilities in Asia rather than in the U.S., then that's a shift in productive capability. And neither economic theory nor common sense asserts that that shift is automatically good for the United States. Since globalization, as I said, does involve productivity changes, free trade theory does not apply, and the forecast of a benign outcome is not based on that theory. Again, globalization is not free trade. However, economic theory is not a blank on this subject. What economic theory does show about productivity shifts is they tend to benefit the home country when its trading partner is a relatively undeveloped country. As the trading partner becomes more developed, the benefits decrease. And pretty soon you reach a point where further development of the trading partner is detrimental to the home country. You are losing more to the new competitive ability of your trading partner than you gain from cheaper goods. Although it is common to propose tariffs under these circumstances, the only real antidote in this situation is to do the things that increase U.S. productivity. And in a globalized world, that is not easy. The desire to increase productivity often translates into asking for improved education and more money for R&D, often K-12 education. Proposals of this sort about education and R&D can in themselves only be helpful. They can only be harmful if they create the belief that these measures are enough to deal with the problem. They are only a first step, but a good one. The difficulties in improving education are well known, and those improvements are slow to come by. And also, there are limits to what can be done by education. We cannot expect education to turn out Americans who are so productive that they are worth hiring in place of the four or five Asians that can be hired for the same amount of money. More R&D, too, can only help. But the R of R&D, basic research, that knowledge is spread around the world rapidly today, so it becomes the common property of those who are developed enough to know how to use it. And there are more of these than ever before. Development, the D, may well result in greater productivity, but that productivity may well today in a globalized company itself be abroad, and it will not result, therefore, in the greater productivity of American workers or of the American economy. These measures are all good. They were even better in the past, but in today's globalized world, their effect is somewhat weakened by globalization. However, there are measures that work even in a globalized world because they tend to align company and country interests. And in looking at such approaches, we will be following in the footsteps of the Asian countries themselves. The Asian countries have made it profitable, and that's what companies need, for foreign, often U.S. corporations, to create high-value jobs in their countries. And they do this by offering tax and other incentives, as well as an undervalued currency, that make it profitable for corporations to locate high-value jobs in their countries. And we should consider incentives that reward companies in the U.S. for the same thing. If we want high-value added jobs, let us reward the companies for producing such jobs, whether they produce that through the use of R&D, through the use of more efficient manufacturing, through marketing, through a better way to deliver a service, or through any form of American ingenuity, by any means at all. Let us reward the end result. To show that such incentives exist, let me briefly outline one, and this is only suggestive. We could have a corporate tax rate that would be scaled to the value added per American worker, full-time equivalent worker, of corporations operating in the USA. Companies with high value add per U.S. employee would get a low rate, a low tax rate. A company with low value add per U.S. employee would get a high rate. This tax could be made revenue neutral, very important. Right? It would be an incentive for companies with high value-added jobs to locate and keep their operations in the U.S., and it could be as strong or as weak an incentive as desired. Let me finish by saying that in this country, we have had a remarkable culture of entrepreneurship that has helped ideas to become reality and which provides rich rewards for those accomplishments. And we've had corporations in which it was recognized that it was in their own interest to invest alongside the U.S. workforce and make it possible for that workforce to increase its productivity. We need to consider incentives such as the tax mentioned above to realign the profit interests of corporations with the interests of the country. And since we are dealing with globalization, not free trade, that alignment today is not automatic. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, sir. And Dr. Duesterberg.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for having me at this important hearing. And in the spirit of your admonition that this is a fact-finding hearing, I provided a lot of facts and figures in my testimony, and I will refer to some of the charts in my testimony as I go through my brief synopsis. The subject of this hearing is of vital importance to manufacturers for the simple reason that this sector is more engaged in the global economy than the much larger services sector. It's also a leader in innovation, accounting for over 60% of private sector research and development in the United States and more than three-quarters of patents granted in the United States. Moreover, it's been subjected to foreign competition for the last 30 or 40 years, so the experience of the manufacturing sector may shed some light on the future trajectory of the impact of globalization. In fact, the pressures of globalization have forced manufacturers to become leaders in finding ways to adapt to this competition. One of the major results of this competition has been to require them to find new ways to do things in a much more efficient way. They've realized the benefits of strong productivity gains. And figure 3 on page 3 of my testimony illustrates the strong acceleration in manufacturing labor productivity since the 1980s and the superior performance of in productivity of the manufacturing sector in our economy. Productivity gains have created what is often referred to as a paradox of manufacturing. The sector is smaller in some very visible respects, such as employment and percentage of GDP, but it is much more global. While smaller, manufacturing has maintained its global position. Figure 6, which is on page 5, shows that the U.S. share of global manufacturing output has actually increased slightly from about 22.9% in 1980 to 23.8% in 2003. More impressively, Figure 7 shows that the U.S. manufacturer share of global high-tech output increased from approximately 25% in 1980 to 42.5% by 2003, which is the latest year for which we have data, which is a subject in and of itself. A few myths and beliefs about globalization viewed from the perspective of multinational manufacturers who are the most engaged in the global economy. In the first place, there's not a rapid offshoring on a net basis of jobs. Figure 9 shows that the employment share of U.S. parent multinationals has remained relatively flat as a share of total non-bank private industry between 1988 and 2004. The data show that an increase in employment at foreign affiliates is positively correlated with growth in jobs at the domestic parent. While overall job losses do affect the domestic manufacturing sector, they are not amongst the most globally engaged parts of the manufacturing sector. There are myriads of benefits from engagement abroad, not the least of which is access to foreign markets, which are in many cases the fastest growing on a relative basis in the world. And in fact, the primary reason for locating a manufacturing facility abroad is for access to local and regional markets. In fact, 90% of the production of foreign affiliates of U.S. manufacturers are sold into the local markets and less than 10% back to the United States. Finally, I would note that 64% of U.S. employees of foreign affiliates are in high-wage countries such as Europe and Japan and Canada, and overall the employment at multinational corporations, including the United States, about 90% of the employment is still in high-wage countries. Now let's turn to a little bit of data on the globalization of innovation. In fact, most of the data that we have refers to research and development. R&D is the least globalized activity of U.S. multinationals. Foreign affiliates represent 31% of all sales and 28% of employment, but R&D only represents about 13.7% among foreign affiliates. This is up slightly from 11% in 1990. Furthermore, more R&D is insourced into the United States than it is outsourced. Companies such as Siemens and others do a great deal of research, the German auto companies, the Japanese auto companies. The growth of R&D spending by U.S. parent companies in the United States increased at a 6.1% annual rate since 1990, while the increase in R&D spending among foreign affiliates grew at 6.2% rate, so the vast amount of the research remains in the United States. And again, I would emphasize that more R&D is insourced than is outsourced. In sum, while R&D activity and technological excellence is being globalized, and there is evidence that, as I believe the chairman cited and the ranking member cited as well in the Texas study, there is some evidence of increased globalization of R&D and countries such as China, partly through tax incentives and other means, are also increasing their R&D activity. But nonetheless, the U.S. maintains a commanding presence in research and development activity. I would emphasize, though, that while R&D activity is certainly of interest, it's only one component of a very complex ecosystem that produces what has come to be known as innovation. Whether R&D offshoring, if it accelerates, is indicative of the true globalization of a broad class of activities that enter into the innovation process is, at the moment, a very open question. Many other factors, technical workforce, legal propensity, legal protection for intellectual property, financial innovation, and more qualitative factors such as propensity for risk-taking, all figure prominently into the generation of innovation. Unfortunately, there's a paucity of data available that has left many crucial questions about the globalization of innovation activity basically unanswerable at this point in time. We at the Alliance have done a little bit of research to try to understand better the complex activity of innovation. Without going into a great deal of depth, we've tried to explain what both product innovation and process innovation, the way you make things, which is of equal importance. Our results show that variables such as capital investment, university industry linkages, and the employment of science and engineering personnel are important ingredients for innovation. The results of our empirical work show that were particularly interesting with regard to basic R&D expenditures in universities and colleges. Our research indicates that a 10% increase, for example, in nominal dollar expenditures on basic science at universities and colleges generates, after a lag, a 4.16% increase in utility patent approvals, and with a little bit longer lag, a 4% or nearly 2% increase in the multi-factor productivity growth in manufacturing. All of this suggests that we need to do a great deal further work on fully understanding the process of innovation, and the data is just not available yet. A lot of data needs to be gathered in order to accomplish this. This is especially true given the anecdotal evidence of the potential globalization of R&D activities and the fear that innovation will be outsourced in its wake. We at the Alliance are undertaking some of this research along with many other institutions around the country. Finally, in terms of the policy implications what I've reported here today, we think that our efforts should be directed to expanding the extent of free trade while working to end the many unfair trading practices that still plague our ability to access foreign markets. It's a poorly understood fact that only 5% of the trade deficit in manufactured goods, which is, of course, is 75% of our overall deficit, is with countries where we have free trade agreements. While these same countries account for 30% of our imports and over 44% of our exports. To remain globally competitive, we need, first and foremost, to keep our domestic economy strong with a sensible monetary policy that we've been blessed with for a number of decades, and maintain the low-tax, spending-constrained, low-deficit fiscal policy that still satisfies the needs of crucial social goals. Over time, we will need to increase national savings, both to curb our trade deficit and to fund needed capital and social investment. Moreover, we need to be increasingly mindful of the structural costs that our businesses face in a world where capital is increasingly mobile, an issue investigated in depth in some of our studies. In particular, we need to address the high differentials in corporate taxes, tort litigation costs. Of course, we spend more on tort litigation than we do on R&D in the United States. High natural gas costs, health care costs that are borne by employers, and regulatory burdens of U.S. firms as compared with our leading global competitors. Finally, we need to combat the mercantilist policies, such as maintaining undervalued currencies, which Martin alluded to, theft of intellectual property, and subsidizing export industries practiced by competitors such as China and other Asian nations. Finally, we need to put our own house in order, as the others have mentioned. We need to ratchet up investment in the sciences and engineering disciplines so crucial to innovation and to attracting the domestic students to these fields. And finally, we need to think seriously about creating a better career path for U.S. scientists and engineers. Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for this opportunity to appear before your group.
Well, thank you to the panel. There were a lot of common denominators, a little bit of controversy, but a lot of common denominators. And as we discussed earlier, we do have something of a time crunch. So I had a chance to make a statement earlier, so I'm going to yield my question time to Mr. Baird, who I think was our first person to come in.
I thank the chairman.
And I would ask, maybe we might try to keep it to 3 or 4 minutes rather than 5, and hopefully we'll have most people get a chance to participate.
I thank the chairman very much. I've got a number of questions, but I'll be brief. Mr. Gomory, I thought your point about the possible export of technology and innovation was interesting, but it seems companies are in a bind. Let's suppose you make an aircraft, and a country says, we won't buy your aircraft unless you outsource a portion of your manufacturing process. And so you say, well, okay, you can make the composite wings. Then they acquire the knowledge of the composite wings. How do you deal with that?
Well, that's, of course, a very good point. Right? And I would like to stress that the problems here are system problems. The companies are doing what anyone else would have to do. Right? It's not that they are disregarding, it's that the incentives that are provided are irresistible. Okay? And I think basically we have to provide counter incentives. There's just no other way. That
what would a counter incentive look
in
like?
In that case, I'd have to think. I just don't know.
Okay. I'm going to say your name wrong. Duesterberg, this point you made at the end, I'm not sure I fully understand it. Maybe you can explain it to me a little bit. Poorly understood fact that only 5% of the trade deficit in manufactured goods with countries, we have free trade agreements, but et cetera, et cetera. Elaborate on that for just a second.
Well, we have NAFTA, we have CAFTA, we have some free trade agreements with smaller countries. The only point of this was that our trade deficit with the countries with which we have FTAs is only a very minor part of our overall trade deficit.
Yeah, well, explain how that works.
Well, the overall majority is, of course, with Asian countries. Mm-hmm. We don't have FTAs with them. So the simple point is that countries with which we have FTAs, we seem to do better with.
So your point being that an FTA alone is not the cause for our trade deficit or the export of jobs.
That's correct.
How are we to proceed in keeping innovation domestically? If you could do one thing, what would it be? Very briefly, each of you, start with Dr. Blinder, what would the one thing be? Dr. Baily?
Well, I think that's right. That's probably the one thing I would do. We have to make sure that our corporate tax system does not encourage people to move jobs overseas also.
Dr. Gomory? I'm sorry, I can't hear you, sir.
Yeah. I think if we reward the creation of high value added jobs with a low tax rate, we will see a surge of invention, of ways to take things that are today very labor intensive and make them into high value jobs. It is the need for end jobs that drives both invention and ultimately scientific and engineering jobs. Many people are shying away from scientific and engineering jobs, not because of lack of education. More people enter college wanting to get an engineering or science degree than we would ever know what to use. Well, that's a fact. That's not a well-known one. But they do not see a good career. So we have to create a demand if we're going to have a larger stream. And just
having, you know, fellowships and things, won't do it.
So just encouraging people to do more math and science and all the stuff we've been doing.
I think that's all good, but if there's no demand, people are too smart to do that.
Yeah. Right. Dr. Duesterberg?
Well, this is not original, but I'd go back to the experience of the 1960s and 1970s when we had an excitement about a science and technology program, partly driven by the threat of Sputnik, first of all. Then we had the Apollo program, which was visionary. We spent nearly 0.75% of GDP on the Apollo program at its height, so we need to have an adequate level of funding for the basic research, but we also need to value at a national level the sorts of tasks, jobs, training that go into motivating people to want to be a part, make the sacrifices to be a part of the process.
Thank you. You're back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Spirit. Mr. Hall.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Dr. Bunder, you estimated that there are potentially 30 to 40 million jobs that could be offshore, but then as you read your testimony on through, it seemed like you've ameliorated that a little bit by saying that not all will be. How do you arrive at that number, and what do you mean by not all will be? What changes that?
Sure. Let me take it backwards. If you think about the manufacturing sector, where we've had offshoring for a very long time, we still have about 10% of Americans working in the manufacturing sector. We have not lost all those jobs, though they are all or almost all of them potentially offshoreable in the sense that one could build a factory to do this or that in another country and then ship the goods back to America. The crucial defining characteristics to me in trying to do this separation between potentially offshoreable and not potentially offshoreable jobs were two. The less important was requiring physical proximity. So if you sell hot dogs at Yankee Stadium, you have to be at Yankee Stadium. That's less important. The more important one, covering many more jobs, was the importance that I mentioned, the importance of face-to-face contact. If it's either absolutely essential that it be done face-to-face, or the task is done very much better face-to-face, so if you try to electronically deliver it, you lose a lot in the process, those jobs are not very likely to be offshore. So that goes to cultural sensibility, feel and touch, that kind of things. Jobs that require that as essential inputs are not going to be replaced by internet messages.
Dr. Duesterberg, in your testimony you say that an increase in employment at foreign affiliates is positively correlated with growth in jobs in this domestic parent. How does this mesh with the overall American manufacturing job losses over the past decade, and how would you characterize the role of domestic entrepreneurship in the innovation strategies of a multinational company? What's happening here? You gave good advice to Chris Cox and Dan Quayle just yesterday. How about giving us some leadership on this?
Well, the seeming paradox is that the companies that are most globally engaged tend to be the ones that are avoiding the job losses and, in fact, increasing in a very slight way.
Like
Intel, like a Microsoft, like a Nike, like a General Electric. I'll offend everybody else by not mentioning them, but globally engaged companies that are successful, Boeing is another example. The ones that are hurt are the companies that are unable to make the sorts of investments both here and abroad to be competitive with the growing competition from low-cost producers in China and elsewhere. So the job losses tend to be concentrated in those sorts of smaller, frequently smaller industries that are just don't have the wherewithal to become as globally engaged as they could. What should we do? We should do everything we can to maintain the environment here in the United States that supports innovation. We're a very litigious society. We've all talked about the problems with the education system. We're not providing enough good scientists, engineers. There are very real issues with access to foreign markets as well. Martin mentioned the currency undervaluation of China, and for many years, many other Asian currencies. That's a real problem. Subsidies to production abroad are a very real problem. I mean, after all, in China used to give a few years ago a 5-year tax break, full tax break to companies that located there for the purpose of exporting outside of the country, plus 5 more years as at half tax rates. They've recently changed that, but that sort of activity certainly doesn't help. So it's a two-pronged approach. Do what we can to make the environment for innovation and for entrepreneurship strong here. Combat unfair trade practices abroad.
Thank you, Doctor.
Let me just wind up with one last question. Other than we're talking science and math and all we're going to do to get these kids interested in it and participating in it and how great it's going to be for them and paying teachers more and all that, other than that, what can we do to change our educational system so our students are going to be ready to compete with the youngsters from China and India and anywhere else? To you, Dr. Duesterberg.
Well, as I mentioned and answered an earlier question, I think the sort of the culture is not necessarily as supportive as it should be of people entering these fields. I mean, I remember when I went to college in the 1960s, everybody wanted to be an aerospace engineer because we were doing the Apollo program. It was exciting. Commercial aviation was just taking off. It was a very remunerative field. Or they wanted to go into IBM, where Ralph was working, because we were, you know, inventing the computing industry. Now things have changed. We don't value that sort of activity as much culturally. You know, there's a million other things that we could do to strengthen our educational system. I happen to like Chairman Gordon's idea of helping to produce better math and science educators at the secondary and elementary school level.
After quoting such a wise person, I hate to cut you off, but I would like that for as many people to participate as possible. So, Dr. Wu, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for always giving me that promotion to doctor. My mother really appreciates it. For the witnesses, I have been thinking about the aspect of offshoring R&D and academic work. I mean, you all have talked about service jobs and manufacturing jobs. I used to represent academic institutions, and I know that there's certain deals that folks cut. That the federal government supports research. We're unlikely to support research at foreign institutions, but the private sector supports much more research, and that money is hot money. It's mobile money. It can go to a U.S. university or it can go elsewhere. Are you all concerned about foreign institutions, educational institutions, in essence cutting our private sector or global companies a better deal on R&D and the true outsourcing of innovation so that, for example, with respect to this panel, if we were to do this hearing in 10 or 20 years, instead of having someone from Princeton, we'd have someone from Prague. Instead of the rest of y'all, you know, we'd be bringing in experts from New Delhi or Beijing instead. Is that a real issue or not?
Well, of course, nobody really knows the answer to that. But my guess is, at least for the time being, it's not too much of an issue. We still, I don't want to say we have a monopoly, but which we don't. But we have a huge comparative advantage in higher education. The great preponderance of the great research universities of the world are in the United States, and I think that's likely to be true for a long time. That said, it's only natural for the rest of the world gradually to catch up to us. So we can't expect to have this hegemonic position forever.
I agree with Al on that. I'm willing to bet there are quite a lot of foreign graduate students in your classes. So I think I suspect Alan's own job actually is a little dependent on the global economy. But I think if we maintain the strength of our universities, not just the top 10, which are so strong, but a lot of our state and local universities as well, I think we will maintain our position. And as Alan said, there's nothing wrong with other countries doing academic research. And by the way, there are foreign companies that support academic research in the U.S.
I yield back.
Thank you. Ms. Biggert?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for a really very informative presentation. I think that we in this committee have been talking about the globalization, about being competitive in a global economy, but I think you put all the pieces together, and I don't think we're doing a good enough job. I don't think we're doing a good enough job in education. You're talking about the universities, but I also serve on the Education Committee. We've been looking at the results of No Child Left Behind, and I think it's pretty dismal, actually. I mean, we've increased average yearly progress. We have increased performance, but when you think about that, it's only 40-45% of the students are even meeting grade level, and we say that that's great. We're not really we're not going to attract kids to science and math if we're not really giving them the basic education starting out and the will to study. You look at China, and the kids are going to school all year long. They're practically sleeping at their desks, and there is a real drive, to excel and to surpass us. And I don't think that we want the quality of life where our kids go to school 7 days a week, 24 hours. But I think that we do need to maybe we have the nation at risk, and you're talking about Sputnik and all the things that challenged it. But what can we do really to really change that and make people have a love of learning, I guess, that they don't seem to have now. We've got a love of leisure and grade inflation and things like that that it really troubles me. That besides the our immigration policies, that we're not bringing in students from other countries as much, mainly because we've cut off a lot of that since 9/11. We talk about the innovation and creativity is the only way that we're going to stay ahead, and yet we're not. I think members of Congress have finally realized research and development is so important, but a lot of people don't realize that yet. May help me out with that, or is that too broad?
I'll take a little stab. I can't really give you deep help because this is a huge question and there aren't clear answers. But to harken back to something I wrote in the testimony, I think we need to move away faster than we are from the 19th century educational system that we put in, featuring sit at your desk, be quiet, and rote learning, where you fill in the little thing with the electronic pencil. Life is not like that, and to the extent life is like that, it's either done better by a computer or a low-wage person in a developing country in the future than by an American. We need to get kids doing more playing with ideas, more creativity, less rote learning. If you don't mind my saying so, since you mentioned you're on the Education Committee, I've written, I believe this, that not because of accountability reasons, which I'm all for, but because of the focus on standardized rote learning tests and the teachers teaching to the tests, which we see all over America, No Child Left Behind is pushing us in the wrong direction, I believe.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. And, since you were so nice, let's let Mr. Reichert have the remaining portion of your time, 2 minutes.
I'll just make it real quick. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Russia has lightweight, strong titanium. Boeing manufactures the struts for the 787 in Russia. Is that the cheapest way to do it? Manufacture in Russia and ship the finished struts to the U.S., or is it cheaper to ship the titanium and manufacture in the United States? And a follow-up question: our Coast Guard helicopters are re-engineing, and they're buying their engines from France. And I'm told that the only reason they're buying them from France is because It's the only place that makes them. Why doesn't the United States make engines that fit our Coast Guard helicopters?
Well, those are two different questions.
Yes.
With respect to how Boeing carries out its sourcing, it's frequently constrained by the demands of countries which are its customers to do part of their production in that country so that they can sell. This sort of activity is, by and large, if not discouraged, it's made illegal by the global trading system, but it's often left unpassed and not sanctioned. Whether it's the best way to produce is a technical question that I'm not capable of answering, but I think we ought to look very carefully about the requirements by foreign countries for local production as a reason for buying the product. And along those lines, we need to think more seriously as a nation about what our core competencies are in technologies that are related to our national defense. I don't think we've done a very good job of that in the past, and that's something that we're not capable of assessing, but somebody at the Pentagon and elsewhere, while they look at these, should be spending, I think, more time looking at these sorts of questions.
Thank you, Mr. Reichert.
Can I make a quick comment? Yes. That is, that industry, the aircraft industry, and, of course, the military hardware generally, is something where the U.S., I think, has a fairly substantial advantage. Obviously, Boeing is in a struggle with Airbus, but quite a lot of the Airbus is actually made in the United States. I mean, the engines are made, and a good part of the aircraft, a significant part of it. So I think we are also the beneficiary of some of that.
Thank you.
Production.
And let me suggest that all members will have the opportunity to submit questions, and all panelists will have opportunity to submit additional testimony. And Mr. Pinsky, I'd like to yield the balance of our time and whatever nerve you have to stay as long as you'd like.
How much time do we have left in the vote, Mr. Chairman?
35.
All right. Well, I'll try to keep this short. I'll shorten to a couple quick comments and a question. The first thing is, as I was waiting for the vote, I thought was going to happen earlier. I listened to all your testimony from back in my office. I appreciate all your very thoughtful testimony. It's a critical issue. I want to point out one thing, Dr. Gomory, the high value-added jobs. I think that is critical that we keep talking about high value-added jobs, because I understand, and I'm not sure everyone does, that some jobs are better jobs than others, not just individually for those who are employed there, but for the implications, the multiplicative impact they have on the economy, and especially on those local communities. As I've seen manufacturing jobs leave from my district, just because a guy can go down the street, get a job for Flippin' Burgers, he makes much less money, but it also has an impact on the community that is very significant in other jobs that are there. So we have to keep focusing on that, and I also think that it's important that we can take care of our own national defense, because when it comes time, I don't want to rely on another country to produce things for us, for our national defense. We need to take care of also problems with exchange rates. I think Mr. Duesterberg, Mr. Dr. Comrie for Dr. and Doctor for mentioning those things, exchange rates. We need to have fair trade. The question I have very quickly, and maybe get some comments later from you in writing, Dr. Duesterberg talked about the impact that basic research has on our economy. I just want to open that up. I want to ask you if you have any more information on that, if you can provide any more, and maybe I'll just invite everyone else on the panel. If you have something really quick to say right now, let us know, and if you could provide any additional information on what impact do we have facts and figures on the impact that this research done at our universities has on our economy. Does anyone want to say anything quick, or we're just going to...
There's been quite a bit of academic literature written on the spillovers from university research to private sector research, and you can see that in action. I mean, Silicon Valley is in some sense a reflection of the strength of of Stanford and Berkeley. You see around Boston the strength of the high-tech sector there. Austin also with the strength of the University of Texas. So there's definitely been quite a bit written about the benefits that you get, the spillover benefits. If you have a very strong academic center, you also get private sector benefits and private sector jobs created.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Gordon has to leave, so we have to run for votes. Although I'm being told I can stay here and ask more questions, I think I'm going to slow down my run. And I want to thank you for your testimony. And if I can adjourn the hearing from here instead of over in that official chair, I adjourn this hearing. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, sometimes I've been at these. He's been here, so at least we had quite a good audience and the rest of it.
We didn't get
it. Yeah, that's what they said, actually. Yeah.
I heard a buzzing, but I didn't see the clock. It's got light.
I noticed that Mark Twain's been shortchanged. We've got these quotes are all from foreign sources here. I think we should do something about that.
Of all places, you're American. You're right.